In detail, but what we're trying to achieve is to sort of like focus on a couple of key presentations and just give you the spirit and the ideas that are behind them. So the welcome or workshop aims and objectives, I'll click through this because a lot of the stuff we discussed. So of course the setting, Europe is multilingual, this is part of our identities, of our culture, etc., and it's extremely strongly supported by the EC. But of course, nobody speaks all of these 26 languages or 24 official languages plus two CEF languages. And so we don't want digital oblivion for languages, and we don't want silos created by languages, barriers to communication. And of course, language technology is kind of like a part of that, sort of like bridging this, but not just language technology, but human translation, first and foremost. I should have done that. But the trouble is there's much too much to translate, can never be done all by human translation, so we need some technology support. And this is machine translation. It's automated translation rather than automatic. Automated means that humans are required to post-edit, to make it perfect, etc. In some situations, we will also use purely automatic translation where no human is available to make it perfect. And of course, CEF at AT is within this family, and it's also supporting this vision or ideal of a multilingual single digital market, which is a very concrete goal in Europe. It's for free, it's run at the moment by MT at EC, and we need to adapt the system to the best of our needs, because it's different from the previous systems that were targeted at EC communication and inside EC communication, but this is sort of like goes beyond, it goes to national, countries, citizens, NGOs, services, and we need the local data to make this happen, because these are machine learning based systems, and they only know, they know best what they've trained on, and without the right data it just wouldn't work. Okay, then a little bit on the workshop objectives. Again, it's a high level summary. I think we talked about most of these things. The key players, you, of course, the public service NAPs, the representatives from the various institutions. A little bit high level stuff, that this is not sort of like imposed from the outside. It's not us parachuting in and saying, like, give us your data, otherwise, you know. The exact contrary. It's like, you know, helping our local languages to avoid digital oblivion, supporting our languages and all that, the national anchor points, what we can, what we want to achieve, what we can offer. And then let me just sort of like delve a little bit on this. I know it's sort of like, you know, a bit fast, but that's kind of like a rough program. And the reasoning behind this program is, of course, first of all, setting the context. That is sort of like the local hosts, thanking them appropriately because they make a huge contribution to the success of this. And then we go from the general to the specific. So the first is kind of like workshop aims and objectives, very, very high level. Then there's a presentation from the EC, which Kimmo is gonna give. And this sort of like gives a little bit of the context, you know, multilingualism in Europe, the support for multilingualism, the CEF, where is CEF AT embedded within, within the CEF? And then we move in from the general context, the European context, to the specifics of the local language. And here it's language and language technologies in country X, for example. One important feature of the day is to get as much audience participation and engagement as possible. And the panels are one of the key elements for getting that. Of course, questions can be asked after each of these presentations, but the panels are the first sort of like port of call where we have people from our constituency that we want to talk to and make them part of the program, shape the program. And the first one is a panel on multilingual public services in this country. And the idea here is, so what are the most important languages? What are the pain points in the language services? Is the situation shifting? Like 10 years ago, what were the main languages that you were supporting? Is this changing at the moment? What are your needs? And really hear from our audience rather than us sort of like talking to them. This is really the exact opposite. And then after the coffee break, we go towards a section where we give a little bit of the motivation. Why is data so important? It's because these systems are machine learning based, most of them at least. I mean, for Hungarian, it might be different. We'll see about that. And for these systems, like, data is just king. Without the right data, nothing is going to work. So there is sort of like, you know, a high-level presentation on how statistical machine translation works, but in pictures, you know, just for people to our colleagues from the public services to get a key awareness that, you know, the right kind of data is required to do the right kind of job. If you don't have the right kind of data, the systems just won't do it for you. And then immediately after that is again a presentation from the EC, and this speaks to the question, if I give data apart from these high-level goals, are there any specific benefits or returns that I can expect? Yeah, and this is the CEF-AT designed for the specifics of the public services, the CEF building blocks, etc. Then we have lunch, and then we come back to the key topic of data. What kind of data is needed? And this is very, very high level. Monolingual, bilingual, dictionaries, concept hierarchies, etc. And this block is very much taken care of by Khalid and his team. And then as soon as you speak about data, legal issues arise. You know, they came to the fore in the discussion earlier on. So there's copyright, there's ownership, there is sort of like personal information that cannot be disclosed by disclosing data, etc. So we have a presentation on that. This also covers core aspects of the PSI, the Public Service Initiative. And the basic message here is positive. Yes, you can. You can give data provided there's no personal data involved, provided the data has been captured with public money. It's the taxpayers who have paid for this data, so it should be available to the citizens. And the EC is just a conduit for making this this available, but should also be available for companies, etc. Yep. And then, again, we have a panel. And with that context, we then zoom in kind of like, you know, what is the data that we might have in our particular country? Is there something, you know, do we have already people representing public services that have already worked with machine translation, examined machine translation, or worked with human translators, or in the archival offices, etc. What data is available, irrespective of whether or not it can be made available? You know, just sort of like, again, hearing from our audience, you know, what do they have? Are there things that we're not aware of, etc. Really important dimension of the sort of like dramatic development of the day, I think. Then we have a coffee break, and then we have a very practical slot. If I have data, how can I share it? It's about sharing data. It's not about sort of like collecting data, taking it away from anybody. It's just taking a copy and making it available. You will still keep your data. That's very, very important. It's really all about sharing, and for this greater good, if you like, but also for the very practical benefits. Then we have a panel, kind of like, that's pretty much at the end of the day. You know, it's a panel. Kind of like, you know, given that we've now seen everything, the context, what we're trying to achieve, can we actually engage, you know? And this is sort of like very tentative from the representatives from the public services. Do we see a possibility of our institution engaging in this operation? And I think that was quite positive in the workshops that we had. And of course, you handpick the people as well, I think, sort of like, you know, it goes without saying. And then at the end, because, you know, this is not the end of the story. Once we have sensitized our audience to the value of data, how can we manage this data better going into the future? Because we don't want this to be sort of like a one-size.